William Collins presents GCHQ, the uncensored story of Britain's most secret intelligence agency, by Richard J. Aldrich. Read by Peter Noble. Introduction. GCHQ, the last secret? GCHQ has been by far the most valuable source of intelligence for the British government ever since it began operating at Bletchley during the last war. British skills in interception and code breaking are unique and highly valued by our allies. GCHQ has been a key element in our relationship with the United States for more than 40 years. Dennis Healy, House of Commons, 27th of February, 1984. GCHQ is the last great British secret. For more than half a century, Government Communications Headquarters, the successor to the famous wartime code-breaking organisation at Bletchley Park, has been the nation's largest and yet most elusive intelligence service. During all of this period, it has commanded more staff than the Security Service, MI5, and the Secret Intelligence Service, SIS, combined, and has enjoyed the lion's share of Britain's Secret Service budget. GCHQ's product, known as Signals Intelligence or SIGINT, constituted the majority of the secret information available to political decision makers during the Cold War. Since then, it has become yet more significant in an increasingly wired world. GCHQ now plays a leading role in shaping Britain's secret state. And in the summer of 2003, it relocated to a spectacular new headquarters that constituted the single largest construction project in Europe. Today, it is more important than ever. Yet we know almost nothing about it. By contrast, the wartime work of Bletchley Park is widely celebrated. The importance of decrypted German communications, known as the ultra-secret, to Britain's victory over the Axis is universally recognised. Winston Churchill's wartime addiction to his daily supply of ultra-intelligence, derived from supposedly impenetrable German cipher machines such as Enigma, is legendary. The mathematical triumphs of brilliant figures such as Alan Turing are a central part of the story of Allied success in the Second World War. The astonishing achievement of Signals Intelligence allowed Allied prime ministers and presidents to see into the minds of their Axis enemies. Thanks to SIGINT, we too can now read about the futile attempts of Japanese leaders to seek a favourable armistice in August 1945, even as the last screws were being tightened on the atomic bombs destined for Hiroshima and Nagasaki. However, shortly after VJ Day, something rather odd happens. In the words of Christopher Andrew, the world's leading intelligence historian, we're confronted with the sudden disappearance of Signals Intelligence from the historical landscape. This is an extraordinary omission, which, according to Andrew, has seriously distorted the study of the Cold War. Intelligence services were at the forefront of the Cold War, yet most accounts of international relations after 1945 stubbornly refuse to recognise even the existence of the code breakers who actually constituted the largest part of this apparatus. Nor did this amazing cloak of historical invisibility stop with the end of the Cold War. In 2004, following the furore over the role of intelligence in justifying the invasion of Iraq, Lord Butler, a former cabinet secretary, was appointed to undertake an inquiry into British intelligence and weapons of mass destruction. Butler's report into the workings of the secret agencies was unprecedented in its depth and detail. However, GCHQ is mentioned only once in the list of abbreviations where we are told that the acronym stands for Government Communications Headquarters. This is all we learn, for in the subsequent 260 pages, the term GCHQ is in fact never used, and the organisation is never discussed. The subject is simply too secret. SIGINT was not simply a Second World War phenomenon. Throughout the 20th century, Britain's codebreakers continually supplied Downing Street with the most precious jewels of British intelligence, discreetly delivered in what became known as the Blue Book. Nicholas Henderson, formerly Britain's ambassador to Washington, explains, "All prime ministers love intelligence because it's a sort of weapon. The intelligence reports used to arrive in special little boxes, and it gave them a belief that they had a direct line to something that no other ordinary departments have." It was partly for this reason that British prime ministers never minded spending money on intelligence. Signals intelligence also matters to political leaders because it allows them to hear the authentic voices of their enemies. Although Winston Churchill was the most famous recipient of such material, his predecessor, Neville Chamberlain, was also offered some remarkable insights into the mind of Adolf Hitler. In 1939, shortly after the Munich appeasement, Chamberlain was given an intelligence report which showed that Hitler habitually referred to him in private as der alte Arschloch, or the old asshole. Understandably, this revelation had a profound effect on Chamberlain. However, constant exposure to secrets derived from the world of code breaking, bugging, and other kinds of secret listening has the capacity to induce paranoia. Harold Wilson regularly dragged his private secretary, Bernard Donoghue, into the bathrooms and toilets of Downing Street. Only there, with the taps turned on full and water sloshing noisily in the basins, did he feel immune to the threat of bugs. A top priority for Britain's technical security specialists during the Wilson years was the installation of the latest scrambler phones at the Prime Minister's holiday home in the Scilly Isles, so he could speak to Whitehall without fear of interception. Doubtless, Wilson would have been delighted to learn that some of his opponents felt equally oppressed by electronic surveillance. When Ian Smith, the Rhodesian leader, visited London in late 1965, he insisted on having some of the more sensitive conversations with his delegation in the ladies' lavatory, convinced that this was the one location where British intelligence would not have dared to plant microphones. Secret listening terrified friend and foe alike. Harold Macmillan recalled the almost unbearable sense of oppression he felt on his visit to Moscow to see the Soviet leader Nikita Khrushchev in 1959. His delegation feared that British codes were compromised, and they were unable to talk freely, even outside in the open air, because of constant technical surveillance. He would have been fascinated to learn that at the very same moment, Khrushchev and his immediate circle also felt increasingly anxious about KGB microphones, to the extent that they dared not speak freely, even amongst themselves in their own capital. In June 1966, to his immense fury, President Tito of Yugoslavia discovered that he was being bugged by his own security chief. "Concealed microphones have been installed everywhere," he exclaimed angrily to a friend, "even my bedroom." The supreme example of the way in which eavesdropping could have political consequences was the Watergate scandal, which gradually brought about the downfall of President Richard Nixon between April 1973 and July 1974. Nixon had used a team of former CIA operatives known as the Plumbers to burgle and bug premises used by the Democratic Party. Not everyone was shocked. In 1973, Britain's Prime Minister Edward Heath made a visit to China. Mao Zedong asked him, "What is all this Nixon nonsense about?" Heath asked what he meant by nonsense. Mao replied, "Well, they say he bugged his opponents, don't they? But we all bug our opponents, don't we? And everybody knows it. So what is all this fuss about?" Others took bugging in their stride. When Tony Blair visited India in October 2001, his security team found two bugs in his bedroom and reported that they wouldn't be able to remove them without drilling the wall. Blair decided against making a fuss and quietly moved to another room. Eavesdropping and code breaking are certainly nothing new. Even in medieval times, the crowned heads of Europe had recourse to secretive black chambers, where enciphered letters from diplomats were intercepted, opened, and decoded in order to produce intelligence. However, the modern-day Gchq owes its origins to the arrival of the radio and the enormous impact of science upon methods of fighting during the Second World War. It was the struggle against Hitler that revolutionized the importance of intelligence from enciphered radio messages. Blitzkrieg and surprise attack were the hallmarks of a new style of warfare that arrived in the late 1930s. The sheer speed of war now meant that secrets smuggled under the coat collar of a traditional human spy were no longer of much use to commanders. The codebreakers of Bletchley Park were the perfect answer, offering intelligence in real time from intercepted enemy signals. In some cases, messages sent from Hitler to Rommel in the Western Desert were decoded and arrived on Churchill's desk before they were read by their intended recipient. Soon, Bletchley Park presided over machine-based espionage on an industrial scale. With the onset of the Cold War, SIGINT, as it had become known, seemed equally important for a dangerous new era of nuclear confrontation. Atomic weapons and equivalent breakthroughs in biological and chemical warfare, together with ballistic rockets such as the V-2, against which there was no defense, were the new currency of conflict. World leaders were required to comprehend strange new threats and the accompanying possibility of devastating surprise attack, which Lord Tedder, the British Chief of the Air Staff, called a potential nuclear Pearl Harbor. The precarious world of early warning, deterrence, and targeting had arrived. Military chiefs demanded better intelligence and concluded that global SIGINT coverage was indispensable to the Western Allies. By the mid-1950s, Britain's codebreakers had abandoned their Nissen huts at Bletchley Park for new accommodation in Cheltenham, the distinctive radomes and satellite dishes of which became an integral part of the Cold War landscape. Ironically, the story of Gchq after it entered peacetime in 1945 is very much about military operations and even war. Britain's vast SIGINT program was managed by Gchq, but run in cooperation with the armed services, which used their bases, ships, and aircraft to collect the raw enemy signals. As this book reveals, Gchq sat at the center of a spider's web that consisted of many other hidden organizations, both civil and military, which helped it collect signals intelligence. Many of its stories intertwine closely with Britain's long legacy of small wars and guerrilla conflicts in locations such as Korea, Malaya, Borneo, Aden, and the Falklands. GCHQ's operations also involved hair-raising confrontations with the Russians. Britain ran secret submarine spy missions designed to gather signals intelligence from the Russian fleet. Specially converted submarines entered the protected harbors of the Russian Navy and rose precariously beneath cruisers to within 6 feet of their electronic quarry. Submarines that were sent on SIGINT missions, known to their anxious crews as dodgies or mystery trips, were detected off Murmansk and pursued by Russian destroyers with depth charges. GCHQ's ocean-going activities have been a well-kept secret, But some British submariners still bear the scars of this secret signals war in the far north. Code breaking is sometimes depicted as highly technical. More billion-dollar.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.